want to read with you this morning from the 102nd Psalm, and we'll start at verse 12 and then skip down to verse 24. Read a few verses. I think the verses will be up here on the screen in a minute. Psalm 102. Would you stand with me as we respect God's word and read it together? Psalm 102 and verse 12 says, "But thou, O Lord, shall endure forever, and thy remembrance unto all generations." Verse 24, "O my God, take me not away in the midst of my days. Thy years are throughout all generations. Of old hast thou laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of thy hands. They shall perish, but thou shalt endure. Yea, all of them shall wax old like a garment. As a vesture shalt thou change them, and they shall be changed. But thou art the same, and thy years have no end." Thank you, and you can be seated. I want to talk to you this morning about this question: is God dead? And some of you are going to think, "Well, that's short. Let's say yeah. Let's say no, and go home. That'll answer that." But last week we watched, Sunday night we watched the movie, God is Not Dead. A lot of you were here for that. I appreciate the turnout and the response to that. A lot of you have seen that. The precept of it is that there is a college professor who orders his philosophy students to sign a paper that says God is dead. And if they'll all do that, then he says we can dispense discussing about the existence of God and whether he really exists, and we can move on to some other material. And everyone in the classroom signs that paper saying God is dead, except one person. And he says that he cannot sign it because he doesn't believe that God is dead, and he is a Christian. And the premise of the movie is shows how that this one student, in presenting research and presenting his case before the class, is able to change the mind of every student in the class to where that every one of them changes their position. In the end, they all agree God is not dead. Well, I doubt that any one of you here today would say that you believe that God is dead. You probably wouldn't be here today if you felt that. But sometimes, even though we say that we believe God is alive with our mouth, sometimes in our actions we say something different. And I want you to think with me along that line this morning. Let's think about the ideology and the what's behind the God is Not Dead movement. It has a theology to it. And you know, you'd think, well, if theology is about God, so if God's dead, how can there be a theology behind God is dead? But it goes back to, there's several factors involved in it. One of the factors in it is the theology of deism. Deism is not one particular denomination or a specific religion, but rather it's a particular perspective on the nature of God. The idea of deism is that, well, there is a God who created everything and made everything, but then once he created it, he put it in place, he just said, "I'm out of here." And he went away and sat down, and he lives a life of ease, and he's not bothered by us, and he doesn't bother us, and he's not at all involved in the world and what goes on. He doesn't care what we do or how we do it, and he's never going to have any contact with us again. Deism came about in the 17th and 18th centuries when people became more interested in scientific explanations and discoveries. It denies the Bible. It denies prayer. It denies worship. It denies the miracles. So the religion of deism had an influence on people, some people getting to the place where they have said that God is dead. Of course, atheism has a part in that also. Atheism, of course, is the belief that there is no God. It's the belief that man invented God to explain things that we don't understand. To the atheist, they would say God is dead because God never existed. And so there is no such thing as God. The term atheism is a relatively new term. You don't see anybody claiming to be atheists until the 18th century. Back before then, even every primitive civilization had some kind of worship, and they worshiped some being who they believed brought things into being. But the 18th century is where you first see people identifying themselves as atheists. Atheism has been greatly aided by the theory of evolution, which, and the idea of atheism is, well, since we think we have a scientific explanation for how things came to be, then we don't need God anymore. And so that's how they explain him away. About 13% of the world's population today claims to be atheist. About 4% of the United States population claims to be atheist. Probably the strongest evidence against atheism is the universe itself. Benjamin Franklin once made a model of the solar system, and it had the stars and some of the stars and the earth and the moon and the sun and all the planets. And he had it sitting on his desk, and one day there was a friend of his who came in who was a very avowed atheist, and he noticed the solar system model there, and he remarked about how much time it must have taken someone to make it, and he asked Franklin, who made it? And Franklin replied to him, well, nobody made it. It just appeared out of nothing one day. And the atheist refused to accept that explanation. He said, now that's foolish. I'm looking at it. It's sitting right there. Somebody had to have made it. And Franklin replied to him, well, it's no more foolish than the idea that no one created the universe, of which this is just a replica. So the Bible says that the heavens declare the glory of God and the earth shows his handiwork. The fact that we're here and there are things here and the universe is here tells us that there has to be a God who made it. So that is the explanation against atheism. Another thing that's fueled this theology a little bit, and I had not really heard of this or thought about it much, but there's something, it doesn't really have a name, but you might call it the suicide theorists. And their explanation is this: Jesus claimed to be God, right? Jesus died on the cross, therefore God committed suicide, and therefore God is dead. And so that's the way they look at it and the way they explain it, that there was a God who made things, but since he came to earth and came to the cross and died, then he's not alive anymore. And they say that God is dead. So this is kind of some of the theology that goes behind the ideology that God is dead. There are some historical things about it. I know some of you are not really interested in history, but let me mention a couple of things about it. But I found it really interesting, and I think it helps us maybe understand how people got to this, some people get to this perspective on things. There was a man named Friedrich Nietzsche who lived in the 19th century. His father was a Lutheran minister, and his father died when Friedrich was 4 years old. He was raised by a very strict mother, and he very much disliked the formalism and the restrictive nature of his religious upbringing. He was a good student. He studied and was influenced by Greek philosophy and by the theory of evolution. He turned his back on God. In 1882, he wrote a book called The Gay Science. No, not gay in the sense that people use the word today. But he wrote this book in which, through one of his characters that he named the Madman, Nietzsche stated, God is dead, God remains dead, and we have killed him. His purpose in writing this, he said, was to abolish the traditional morality, Christianity. He thought that man had become advanced enough in his scientific thinking and his education that society had moved past the need for God, and therefore, since we didn't need God anymore, that God was dead. He felt like that God was irrelevant because man had got to the point that he didn't need God anymore. And so the first time you see that phrase written down, God is dead, was by Nietzsche. The 60s in America contributed greatly to this thinking. Some of you are old enough to remember the 60s. I was a teenager then, and I remember some of what was going on. The 60s in America was characterized by the hippie generation, the sexual revolution, drug abuse, and liberalized religion. For these movements to advance, they needed to get people to think less about God. Because if there's God and God says certain things are right or wrong, then that restricts people to do what they want to do. But in promoting the idea that God is dead, then, well, if God's not dead, then we can do whatever we want to. Then there is no right and wrong. And so that leaves us free to follow whatever we want to do. On April the 8th, 1966, Time Magazine published what was later recognized as the one of the 10 most one of the 10 magazine covers that shook the world. The cover said, asked this question, is God dead? And it went on to explain how that the modern trend of many theologians trying to come up with new ideas about God and new explanations of God, because the thought was that with society changing and setting up this new morality and situation ethics and things of that nature, that people needed to have a different view of God or to explain away God. And so you have people who call themselves theologians saying God's dead. To me, that's kind of like putting yourself out of a job. If you're a theologian and you say, well, God's dead, then what are you going to write about and what are you going to talk about? But in the opinion of a lot of people, some people anyway, modern science had eliminated the need for religion in the natural world. And God was taking up less space in people's mind and activities. And so Time Magazine asked this question, is God dead? But the idea of is God dead goes back beyond that. If you read with, if you'll listen to me or follow along with me, in the book of Romans, chapter 1, God inspired this to be inspired the Apostle Paul to write this about 2,000 years before Nietzsche. And listen to the way it explains how God came to be dead to some people. And notice in particular what the results of that are. In Romans 1:18, he says, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, and God has showed it to them. He said these people, they were aware of God, they knew that God was there, but what did they do? Well, he says, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. People who say that God is dead, they have no reason to say that. They're without excuse for knowing that there is God. But then he explained the process. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but they became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. He says, he explains what Nietzsche said and what some of the theologians said in the 60s. We're too smart. We don't need God anymore. We can understand things we couldn't understand before. We can figure this out on our own. But professing themselves to be wise, they became foolish. And they changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man and to birds and to four-footed beasts and to creeping things. He says that they turned things around. Instead of worshiping God and making him the final authority, they made themselves the final authority, and they became the center of the universe. And then that changed their lifestyle. It changed their behavior. Wherefore God gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own heart, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature, that is themselves, more than the Creator, who is blessed forevermore. And for this cause God gave them up to vile affections. And here he describes the beginnings, or I don't know the beginnings, but the natural development of what happens when you turn your back on God and you say that he's dead. He says, for this cause God gave them up to vile affections, for their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another. Men with men working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves what recompense of that error was meet. He's describing the sexual perversion that we're seeing more prominent and more accepted in our day. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. And being filled with unrighteousness, fornication, that is sexual sin, wickedness, covetous, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. He's saying they know that there's a God, but they don't want to know Him. He's in their way, so they turn their backs on Him, and then they replace the worship of Him with the worship of themselves. And when they do that, it opens up all kinds of things. And it gets to the point, he says, they not only do the things that God tells them not to do, but they get to the point they enjoy that. And not only that, but they enjoy dragging other people down the same path with them. So this, you see the pattern here. This is not a new thing, trying to say that God is dead and that we don't need God. It goes back to biblical times. It goes back even all the way to the Garden of Eden, when Satan came and tempted Eve and tried to get her to eat the forbidden fruit. He told her, he said, "For God knows that in the day you eat thereof, your eyes will be opened and you shall be as gods." He said, he was telling Eve that, "What you go ahead, don't worry about what God said. You go ahead and disobey God and then you'll become a god yourself. If God is dead, then we become the gods. And we become the ones who are in charge. We become the ones who make decisions." Well, there's a reason I shared all this with you. I want to talk to you about the implications of this. What are the implications of the idea that God is dead? Well, if God is dead, there's no morality. Because if God is dead, there's no sin. God is the one who set the standards of right and wrong. And if God's not there, if God's dead, then anything goes. If there's no God, who can say what's wrong and what's right? If there's no God, who can say that murder's wrong? Who can say that child abuse is wrong? Who can say that stealing is wrong? You know, you say, well, they're just wrong. Well, if there's no God, then why are they wrong? See? Because God is the one who set these standards. So if God is dead, then ignore His standards, His commandments, and His precepts. Just do whatever you want to do if God is dead. If God is dead, there's no Bible. The Bible itself says to study, to show yourself approved unto God. The Bible says desire the sincere milk of His Word that you can grow thereby. But if God's dead, the Bible's a lie. And if the Bible's a lie, then there's no need for us to read it. There's no need for us to study it. I may as well pitch it out the window and read to you out of the newspaper today. If God's dead, don't pay any attention to the Bible. There's no need to. If God is dead, then why would you come to worship? God commands us to worship Him in the beauty of His holiness. It tells us to worship Him in spirit and truth. It tells us to enter His presence with thanksgiving. But why would you need to worship a God who's dead? He can't respond to you. If God is dead, there's no prayer. No need to pray. The Bible tells us pray without ceasing. Jesus said men ought always to pray and not to faint. But prayer is talking to God. If God's dead, why would you talk to Him? He can't hear it. He can't answer back. So if God's dead, then there's no need to pray. If God is dead, there's no church. No need for church. He tells us, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. But, you know, the purpose of the church is to honor God and to preach His Word. So if God's dead, don't worry about getting up on Sundays and coming to church anymore. Because if He's dead, He's not going to know and He's not going to care and He's not going to hear. If God is dead, there's no purpose for living. The Bible tells us that we do have a purpose for living. It says whether you eat or whether you drink or whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. Our purpose for living is to honor Him and please Him. But if God's dead, then what do you live for? What is the motivation behind living here on earth? If God's dead, then it's like it says in Ecclesiastes, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. Everything's empty. There's nothing worth living for. If God is dead, then there's no life after death. If God is dead, there's no heaven, and there's no hell, and there's no hope. If God is dead, then death ends everything. If God is dead, we would sure have a miserable service for Miss Clara on Tuesday. Because if he's dead, I'd have to tell you, she's gone, you're never going to see her again, that's it. If God is dead, then we need to do like the Epicurean said, eat, drink, be merry, because tomorrow you may die. And there's nothing beyond that. If God is dead, there's no judgment. The Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. But if God is dead, there is no judgment where evil is going to be punished and good is going to be rewarded. If God is dead, there is no incentive to do good, and there's no deterrent to do wrong. Because if God is dead, there's not going to be any judgment. We're just going to be dead, and that's it. Jesus, and I doubt anybody here would say, God's dead. But sometimes, do we show that we think He's dead by our actions? Jesus talked about people, He said, they honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. You see, when we don't obey God, our lives say that God's dead. When we disregard His commandments and do whatever we please, our lives say, God's dead. When we don't read and study our Bibles, we say, well, it doesn't matter, God's dead. When we don't worship God, God's dead. When we don't pray, think about that. God is alive. We can talk to Him and He listens to us. But if God's dead, why pray? So when we don't pray, saying, well, God's not alive, He's dead. When we don't go to church like He says, then our lives say, there's no God, He's dead. When we live our lives running around in circles without purpose and without reason, without focus, then our lives say, God's dead. When someone passes on and we grieve like people who have no hope, when we grieve uncontrollably like people that we're never going to see them again, then our lives say that God is dead. When we live just for today, like, and don't consider the eternal consequences of our choices that we make, then our lives say that God is dead. But folks, God's not dead. He's alive. The old preacher Shadrach, Meshach, Lockridge, in talking about this, I couldn't find the exact quotes. I wish I could. They're tremendous. But he said, you say God is dead? God's not dead. I talked to Him this morning. You say God's dead? He's not dead. I wasn't notified, and I'm a member of the family. He said, God's not dead. Who identified the body and where'd they bury Him? And he said, God's not dead. God's not even sick. He's not even tired. God's not dead. So folks, I hope you would share that same conclusion with me today. God's not dead. He's alive. But let's not only say that with our lips, let's prove that with our lives. God's alive. And He invites you to pray to Him and talk to Him and unload your heart to Him and ask Him to meet your needs. Don't live like He's dead. Talk to Him like He's alive. God is alive. Don't come to church like you're just here to see people. Jesus said, where two or three are gathered together, I'll be in their midst. He's alive. And we come and worship Him. God is alive. and the standards of society change from day to day and hour to hour. But because God's alive, His standards are the same. Let's obey Him because He is alive. God's not dead. He's alive. And Jesus promised He's coming back for us one day. And He tells us that that is our blessed hope. And we need to not be slack and careless and getting distracted and going about our own things and getting involved in things that we ought to be ashamed of. But that we ought to live every day with the reality God's alive. And He may reappear on this earth today. God's not dead. He's alive. If He's alive, let's act like He's alive. That's my challenge to you today.